Wonderful. Sit on top of your enemies. By the time we finish, all your enemies will be crushed. You are sitting on them. They are finishing in the name of Jesus. Wow. Wow. Let me pray, say, Elaine, catch your breath for attempting to jump with the young people. It's not a simple situation. Wow. It's too powerful. At least you must lose some 2 kilos during the praises. Wow. Are we here? Wonderful. How to identify anointed people? How to identify anointed people? How many of you know how to identify a beautiful person? When you see a beautiful lady, how do you... What makes a person beautiful? Is it the size of her breasts? Is it the color of her skin? The bum bum. What about the hip? How wide the hips are? Forgive. One day I asked a young man who was on his way to becoming a pastor, what type of woman would you marry? He said he wants to marry a guitar-shaped lady. That gentleman is sitting here today. He's sitting right in this meeting. Here, in this church, in this place, as I'm talking. He's sitting here. He's here. He said he wants to marry a woman who goes like this. Yeah. What a shock. Yeah. So the women who have put on weight a lot, if you saw them a few years ago, you'd be surprised. You grow to understand. I'm telling them. Sure. Yes, that's what you are looking for, brother. Get ready for a shock. A gentleman said, my wife is too fat. I said, he has given you 5 children. She can't remain as she was when you met her. Things will change. How to identify, the way you identify beautiful ladies, there must also be some criteria. Are you in the church? Yeah. The greatest secret for your anointing is to identify the anointed who has been sent to you with his anointing. Amen. That is the great, 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 great secrets of your blessing. When you see somebody, an anointed person, who has been sent to you with his anointing. Amen. To be able to do what an anointed person does, you must have his anointing. Do you understand? If you when you read, let's look at Acts chapter 10, please. Acts chapter 10. All right. I found Acts chapter 10. All right. Now, Peter had been sent to Cornelius' house, and he had gone to minister to them. And the Bible says that as he was speaking, the Holy Ghost fell on them. And they were all baptized. And Peter's recounting the experience. Bible says, verse 34, then Peter opened his mouth and said, "Of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons, but in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That word, I say, ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, and so on and so forth. All right. Him God raised up the third day." Okay, and read on. Verse 44. "While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them, and all them that which heard the word, and they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost." May the gift be poured out unto you too. "For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, Can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we, or in the same way we did?" And he commanded them to be baptized, and on and on. Now, when you read in chapter 11, Peter was recounting the experience that he had in Cornelius' house, and he was telling the church what had happened. And he told them that the same way that they received the Holy Ghost in Acts chapter 2, that the same way the Gentiles also received the Holy Spirit. Amen. The same way that they received the Holy Spirit. You know, they were gathered together, and while they were there in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Ghost came and they spoke in tongues. And Peter said that these guys also, the same way, I didn't have to do anything special. As I was speaking, they began to speak with other tongues. So there's a similarity. You know, when you see an anointed person and you'll be able to do what the anointed person does, if you can receive him, you receive that anointing on his life. Amen. You must be able to identify. Say, this person, number one, is anointed. And number two, he has been sent to me. Not everybody has been sent to you. Not every man of God has been sent to you. But somebody has been sent into your life specifically. Yeah. Some of you, if you're in certain churches, you'd have left the church. You had become an orangu. Or you would have backslidden. Do you see? Some of you, even Bishop Joel couldn't pastor you the way your pastor is pastoring you. Yeah. It's true. There are some people that, I think I'm a good pastor. But the people that maybe didn't flourish well around me, but they flourish well under maybe Bishop Oko. That's how it is. You understand? It's not that, it doesn't mean that Bishop Oko is a better pastor or whatever, but some people, you are able to receive them in a particular way. Do you understand? You have a certain, you don't know how it is. Even some of you, if you're in Ghana, you never join Lighthouse. You had a very bad mind about the church when you were in Ghana. Yeah, I'm telling them. You had a very bad, you couldn't flow with the idea of Lighthouse. But look at you flourishing in America under your pastor. Yeah. So if you didn't like Bishop Doug at all, you're looking at me. You know yourself. You know your mind you used to have. You couldn't flourish. But somehow, you're flourishing under Pastor Stay. Isn't it? You're flourishing under your pastor in your branch. And you're so happy. You're even embarrassed that you used to have that mind about Bishop. You're surprised, isn't it? Yeah, that's how life is. Somebody has been saying to you, may you identify the person so that you can receive his anointing. Amen. He has been said, just like you can't marry everybody. Oh, you know what I'm saying? Every lady is beautiful. Every man is something nice. But you cannot marry everybody. You can't see why you can marry a man like this. Yeah. Sometimes I'm officiating. One time I was officiating a wedding and I was surprised. I tell myself, what is wrong with this lady? That she has agreed to marry this man. I'm telling you, I was really surprised. But I can't say anything. I can't say it loud enough for him, for her to hear. But she has agreed and she's flowing, happy. I'm telling you. Yeah. But that's it. She was able to identify the anointed with his anointing. And follow the anointed with his anointing. And receive. I saw them the other time. The lady was pregnant and she had twins. See, anointed with his. Yeah. You see the man with his anointing and he brought forth twins. So that's how anointed the man is. So identify the one you have been sent to. Amen. And Lighthouse, I believe God has given us a very anointed man. Amen. Very, 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 very anointed. Amen. And we get the anointing on his life if we can receive him as anointed man of God. Amen. It's not the title, whether you're a prophet, pastor, evangelist, teacher or so, that really, really, really matters. It is that gift and the grace. So number one, identify the anointed by the criteria of Jesus Christ. What description did Jesus use to describe anointing? When you read from Luke chapter 7, verse 18, the Bible says, the disciples of John the Baptist came to Jesus and told Jesus, came to John about everything, about everything that Jesus was doing. John called for two of his disciples and sent them to the Lord Jesus and asked him, are you the Messiah or we've been expecting, or we should look for someone else? Then Jesus told John's disciples, 22, 23, go back to John and tell him what you have seen and heard. The blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised to life, and the good news is preached to the poor. And tell him, God blesses those who do not turn away because of me. Amen. So Jesus was very, very specific to send the message to John, letting them know what it is that you should look out for, the Messiah you are talking about. So what Jesus, the quotation that Jesus, what Jesus was saying was referring to John, to the scriptures. And go and tell John that when the Messiah comes, these are the signs that will make you know that he's the Messiah. Amen. The blind will see. The lame will walk. The lepers will be cleansed. The deaf will hear. The dead will be raised. Look, you are going to enter miracle ministry in your life. You are not a school teacher. You are a pastor. You are a woman of God. You are a man of God. From now, you are going to boldly pray for the sick. And the miracle that will follow the prayer that you pray. Can you believe it? That will be the sign that you are anointed. And you receive the anointing of the anointed. Amen. And because when we watch healing Jesus, don't we see amazing miracles? He's an anointed man with his anointing. As we see the anointed man, his anointing will also come upon us. There'll be no church here without miracles. Are you able to receive what I'm saying? Look, you are leaving this place with boldness now. Boldness now. There'll be testimonies in your ministry. I speak it to you this afternoon. There'll be testimonies in your ministry. Miracles will happen in your ministry. Cancers will be healed. Strange sicknesses will be healed. In the name of Jesus. Terminal diseases shall be healed. Doctors shall be amazed at the miracle in your ministry. I believe it. I believe it. Light of temperature, we are entering our season of miracles. We have been known to be very good at teaching, isn't it? Bring stability and other. But now, additionally, we are entering miracle ministries in our lives. Every pastor here shall have miracles in your ministry. Receive it in the name of Jesus. Receive it in the name of Jesus. I'm telling you, your members will be surprised when they see the manifestation of the power of God in your life. I sense it. We are changing levels. We are entering into that season of our lives. Bless God for the teaching anointing. Bless God for all the wonderful things that God has brought us to do thus far. But now, I say, but now, oh yes, 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 yes. It shall be seen all around us. Amazing miracles shall be. You will not be left out of this season. Come on, shout hallelujah. Are you in church? Sit down. We are going to, no, I feel that the deposits of anointing is being placed on our lives. Huge deposits are coming into our lives like never before. Your family members will be amazed. You pray for them and they'll be healed. Do you believe it? Don't put yourself in the corner. Me, I've been called to be a teacher. No. Don't place yourself in that corner. All I do is open to. Thank God for open to. Do you understand? Open to look, open to this. Every day open to. But now, additionally, there'll be miracles. Look, from here, start praying for the sick. Amen. Start praying for the sick. Hallelujah. Call for them and pray and take testimonies. There will be amazing testimonies that you will know that this is God at work. I tell you. Amen. The achievement of Jesus Christ, in which the blind saw, the lame walked, the deaf heard, and the dead were raised, were unique achievements that could only be achieved by someone who was anointed by God. Amen. People, that's what people say about you. That is what people say about you. Something has happened in your life. Testimonies. So many testimonies. Amen. Jesus said, he also preaching to the poor. Special workers. It's also a sign of truly anointed people to be able to minister to poor people. Whom a person preaches to tells a lot about the kind of anointing he's carrying. Hallelujah. You know, preaching to poor people is not easy. Very, 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 very difficult. It's expensive. It's costly. It means a lot. It takes a higher anointing to preach to poor people than to preach to rich people. Yeah. It takes a higher anointing. Number two, identify the anointed by the sign of doing unusual things with ease. Did you see that? So number one is the criteria that Jesus gave. Number two, doing unusual things. With ease. Amen. It's a sign. John 3, 1 and 2. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. No man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Amen. It's not going to be a struggle. Have you ever
prayed for people before and then you are calling for anybody who believes they are healed. And you are afraid to open your eyes. You are wondering, what about if nobody comes? You have no clue. Have you attempted to pray for people who are not well? Pray for the church. If you believe you are not well, place your hand where the sickness is. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you believe you are healed. If you believe, then all of them lift their hands. No. If you can feel in your body you are healed. And then hands, so as if they don't understand what they're saying. I said, if you know you are healed, the hands go. If you now come forward, then will anybody come forward at all? And somebody come forward, say, oh, when I was coming, just when I was entering the door, I had headache. Just when he was entering, the headache came just when he was entering. And the headache has gone. So clap for the Lord, clap for the Lord. You are forcing a miracle. But you see, that's how the river is so. You know, when you go to a source of a river, you discover that it's very negligible. The way the river is flowing from the source, huge rivers in the world, if you go through the source of the river, it's like a little stream, like nothing. But when it goes downstream, you will discover that it gets broader and stronger and faster with tributaries and all that. So your miracle ministry will start like a river, a trickle. Do you understand? A trickle just flowing like that. I'm telling you, flowing like that. But I tell you, as you continue, if only you do not get discouraged. Because the devil's main agenda is to discourage you. Because when you pray, you have a miracle, you organize a miracle service, and then your church is not so large. And maybe there are 35 people or 20 people, and all of them come, and all of them look well. Yeah. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. So when you pray, nobody has, there's not appear to any outstanding miracle. Latin, you can't see it. Everybody there look okay. You see, maybe some running tummy, running stomach, or running nose. I mean, type of something. Do you see? But you see, don't despise the beginning of miracles. Say amen. It will start like a trickle. Some of you must start, I tell them in Ghana, start praying for the chickens in the house. You have chickens in your house. Yeah. Yeah. You know, I started preaching to lizards and cows and things. I tell you, when my mother sent me and I see cows on the road and I start preaching, somebody came to tell my mother once that your son is going crazy. Because when I'm working, I see cows and goats. Bible says, preach to all creatures, isn't it? So I'll be preaching to them. Today is your day of salvation. And I'll be preaching as I'm walking. So somebody else, but I was learning how to preach by preaching to goats and sheep. Today I preach to human beings. Start your ministry in a small way. The river has begun. I said, the river has begun. And when someone said that I had a headache and the headache is gone, it's a miracle. Because in the Bible, we say that one boy got up and told the mother, my head, and he died. My head, and he died. So headache kills human beings. So somebody say that, you know, sometimes the people in the church who make you think that it's not a miracle. Yeah, if you look at their faces, oh, we're expecting one of the miracles that Bishop Doug has been, we've seen on healing Jesus. This one is not so. I had running tummy. I went to the bathroom 2 times, but now when you prayed, I feel that I stopped. And you say clap, and you are forcing them to clap, and they don't want to clap. But you see, don't let them despise the grace that has begun in your life. Something new is starting from today in the name of Jesus. Miracles are going to happen in your ministry. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah.
Amen.
Yeah. There's a lady from Central African Republic. Where are you? Yeah. Stand up, my dear. You know, yeah, you were in Central African Republic, isn't it? I officiated somebody's wedding in Bangui, Central African Republic, some years ago. That's the country. I just met her today, you know, because she knows the couple officiated their wedding. This lady, sorry. Ah, that's your mom. Wow. Fantastic. Her wedding they officiated because the father was high up in politics. They had come to plant a bomb in the hall. Can I ask her where we did the wedding?
and officiate. We're going to suggest they protect because of the lady's father's position in the government. Government soldiers were there, armed men were all there because there was a lot of fighting in the country. And then we did a wedding in a big hall, like a state house, the wedding and everything, and so on. She's called Julie, the wedding there, and finished officially. I went home. In the evening, when we were watching the news, we saw that, they said in the news that bombs had been planted in the hall. That whilst we were there, it would go off because ministers of state were all there. But somehow, the timer didn't go off. Yes. Nothing went off. We finished the wedding and they discovered the bomb after the wedding was over. May the divine hand of God protect and preserve your life. It's a miracle, I tell you, that the bomb didn't go off. I'm telling you, it's deliverance and it's miracle. God's protection shall be on you. Look, you are working with angels. Angels are all around you. God is doing amazing miracles in your life. And through you, many miracles, there will be many testimonies in your ministry. Come on, say amen. Amen. Do you believe it? I said, do you believe it? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm telling you that we are entering a new season. A new season. A new season of miracles, of amazing testimonies. I'm telling you. In the name of Jesus. And they're going to be done with ease. Ease. Unusual abilities. Hallelujah. Yes. You're going to preach with ease. Some time ago, you're always nervous when you're going to preach. But you overcome it in the name of Jesus. Sometimes the nervousness also makes you depend on God. But when you're too confident, you also don't prepare well. You assume that you become like Samson. You know, Psalms Bible says that he woke up at other times thinking that everything is the same, but he did not know the Spirit of God had left him. You know, that is also a danger when you become too casual and too presumptuous. You say, oh, I'll preach like other times. I'll do everything like other times. It doesn't make you depend on God. So God sometimes makes us feel a little uneasy so that we can rely on him and we can depend on him. Say amen. But naturally, you see a certain grace coming on your life. If you look at Andy Crouch, the way he composed music, the way he wrote music, you can see a certain anointing. Do you understand? It comes with ease, and it flows with ease. And you see a certain grace on your life when you begin to do certain unusual things with ease. Amen. Yeah, there are some of you here who are gifted with You're gifted with music abilities. It will begin to excel like never before in Jesus' name. Amen. When I see, Apostle Joel's son. Where is he? Joel. Very gifted. You can say an anointing is on his life. I'm telling you, a certain anointing. His friends all over the world, they contact him to make their music for them. Here he is here in this country, all over. I mean, he's there doing music in a room with a little machine. May that grace be multiplied like never in the name of Jesus. And many of you are like, there are some of you, you have that. Don't take them for granted, though. It's an unusual thing. You know, when something's unusual, you do it, is you think that everybody must be able to understand it. That's why they are very bad teachers. Because they feel that, why don't you understand what it's very simple. Nobody understands mathematics. Do you see? Yeah. Some very brilliant people are very bad teachers. Because they feel that you should understand it. It must be easy. I had a teacher in school. When you ask him, what does it mean? And he read the same thing to you with a louder voice. You must understand it. That's the way he explains the thing. What does it mean to be anointed? It means by the sign of doing unusual thing with ease. That is it. That's how he reads. Louder, so that you can understand it. What a shock. No, I'm telling you, what you find easy, it's not easy with everybody. Yeah, find easy. I love pastoring. Do you understand? I enjoy pastoring.
I really love pastoring. And it's easy for me by the grace of God. It's easy for me to pastor people. Easy for me to flow. It's an anointing. I believe it's an anointing. And also, I believe the grace of God I live in my life is to also assist. It's also an anointing. I don't know why people cannot assist. I can't understand it at all. What a shock. I can't understand it. I don't know why wives cannot flow with their husbands. Just like an assistant. The word assistant, the same word wife. I tell ladies that, look, I've assisted Bishop for 30 years. We have never had an argument. So you, a wife, must assist your husband without argument. They say it's not possible. Why is it not possible? God will help you, I tell you. Are you there? Without argument, ever. Not one day. Amen. If you're doing something with ease, you can't understand why people cannot flow. But God is going to give you the grace to do everything that you called you to do with ease. Amen. You know, have you ever watched Bishop praying for the sick at the crusade? You wonder, no shouting. No, nothing. Okay, I'm going to pray for you. And sometimes, even some of you have wondered before, will anybody come forward? Yeah, I'm going to pray for wherever you are. Place your hand, let's pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, time for miracles. And guess is that, and then come. So who will come? But the people who come say, wow! The ease. I'm telling some of us will beat our chest. Can I go Shabbat? It's not easy, oh. You'll be sweating. The louder your shout, the more the heat, the miracles, the sickness will go away. It's a wonderful thing. When a person is anointed, you know he's anointed. Amen. You will see the ease with which he's ministering. Hallelujah. Look at 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 15. Now, Elisha picked up Elijah's cloak and all that, and then many things happened, and many miracles. So, where is the Lord God of Elijah? Then the river divided, and Elisha went across. Amen. When the group of prophets of Jericho saw from a distance what had happened, they exclaimed, Elijah's spirit rests upon Elisha. All that he did was to take Elijah's coat and then slap the water. And then it parted into two. Easy. Amen. You do miracles with ease. Can you understand what I'm saying? Look, believe everywhere though. It's what you believe that will come to pass in your life. If you believe it, it will come to pass. You will see church growth in your ministry like never before. Yeah. They will come. Your church will cross 30. Amen. You'll get to 60. Amen. You'll get to 100. Amen. Can you receive it? I said, can you receive it? It will not be a struggle anymore. Amen. Hallelujah. There will be people, pastors, pastoring 250 members sitting in your church. Look, let's believe God that we are crossing a certain smallness of churches. Yeah. It's been 5 years. You have been staying at 40. Do you understand? Breaking barriers. Crossing lines. Do you believe it? I'm telling you, there's a time when the thing just goes like this. Goes like this. Not step, but it just goes with speed. Patrick, can you believe it? It will happen in your life. If only you can believe it, you will see it happen practically. We came for this camp to receive an anointing. And may that anointing make ministry easy for you. Yeah, some pastors, some of you are discouraged. I tell you, you came here because you tried everything. Follow up. You call them. You do all those things. You don't know what you have come to your wit's end. Do you understand? You have done so many things and you really wonder what is going to change. May the anointing bring a change in your ministry. In the name of Jesus. You will not be discouraged again. You will not be discouraged again. God will take over the fight. I say he will take over the fight. He will anoint you in this camp to see a certain grace you've never seen before. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. The anointing on our Father may it fall on you. The anointing of a mega church pastor may it fall on you. In the name of Jesus. May God use you beyond yourself. Amen. All right. 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 11. But Jehoshaphat said, is there not yet here a prophet of the Lord that he may inquire of the Lord by him? And one of the king of Israel's servants answered and said, here is Elisha, the son of Shaphat, which poured water on the hands of Elijah. Amen. The king was looking for somebody to do a miracle, somebody to do something, who can hear from God. He said, there's somebody here who is anointed like his father. There will be an identifiable miracle. They can identify where you come from when they see the manifestation of the glory of God. Number three, you identify an anointed person by the peculiarities of his life. Yeah. Matthew chapter 17. Bible says, and the disciples asked him, saying, why then say the scribes that Elias must first come? And Jesus answered and said unto them, Elias truly shall first come and restore all things. But I say unto you that Elias is come already, and they knew him not, but have done unto him whatsoever they listed. Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer, and so on and so forth. Then the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist. Amen. Now you can compare Elijah's ministry to John the Baptist's ministry. You see, both of them were moving around the way the peculiarities and characters of their ministry. Both John the Baptist and Elijah had peculiar feeding and dressing habits. They were all wearing these type of things. Are you the church? They're all eating strange things. And they all had similar graces and anointings. Sometimes I can see that this is John Wesley. This is Kenneth Hagin. Do you understand? This anointing on this man is this man's oil which has fallen on him. When you can see the peculiarities. So that when you look at Bishop, you can see that Ken Hagin's anointing is on him. The ability to write is not easy. Yes. The size of the books, the number of books that have been written, and the books are written for ministry. You can see a similar anointing. It's very peculiar. It's very unusual. You can see clearly. If you learn a little bit, you see that there's something that is very, very real. Number four, the fourth way to identify another person is by the inspirational prophesying, I tell Bishop Joel, when I was in South Africa recently, I saw a certain prophet. It's very scary. They will show his video. He will say that this month of July, two ministers of state will die. One, by accident. Two, by robbery. Armed robbers will kill him. Then when he says that, then they will show the local news, South African Broadcasting News. It's reported that this minister had been shot by armed robbers yesterday. And then a week later, they showed that this person died in a car accident on the road from here to here. So you see his prophecy and you see the fulfillment. In fact, the police have arrested him a number of times. Because you say that someone will die by robbery and then he's shot also. So this man, he must know something about it. It's very, very, very strange. I tell you. I was just wondering what is going on here. And a number of them, It's amazing. Now, this, you identify the anointed by his inspirational prophesying. 1 Corinthians 14:3. But he that prophesies speaketh not unto men for edification, speak unto men for edification, exhortation, and comfort. Amen. Acts chapter 19, verse 6. Can we all read together? Acts 19, 6. Ready, go. Acts chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. Shall we all read it together? Amen. Prophesying is one of the most immediate signs of the presence of the anointing. Amen. We must have prophesying in our churches. Are you there? You must prophesy in your church. You must allow prophesying in our churches. These days, you know, otherwise our churches become like Orthodox churches. Do you understand what I'm saying? Many of us ran from the churches because we said the churches were dead. They don't allow speaking in tongues and all these spiritual gifts. But as we have grown, our churches can easily become like the same type of churches. So organized and everything is in order and all these type of things, we find them strange things. But there must be prophesying in our churches. Must allow speaking in tongues with interpretation of tongues. The first time I met Bishop Dag, 1982 at Legon. I had gone to look for a friend, and this friend was not in his room as he had said he was going to be. So I was coming down from one of the halls, Commonwealth Hall, and I saw this young half caste, lanky half caste, walking on the other side of the road. Before then, you know, before I went to school, a friend of mine who was also going to medical school from the same school, he told me that he went for medical school interview. And when he went, he saw this guy, this crazy boy. He said that when they were all in the room waiting for their turn to be called for the interview, he was just shouting in tongues, shouting in tongues in the room. And he told me that, Yetiseke, I think you will like him. How would I like a crazy man? No, he's telling me that I'm crazy. That's what he's trying to say, isn't it? I will like him because he's a crazy boy. So he told me that I think you will like him. I said, yeah, the way you describe him, I think I will like him. But I didn't know how I was going to meet him. So he told me, half caste boy, described him to me. So when I saw this man walking on the other side with a few people walking with him, about 6-7 people, and then he was speaking in tongues on the road, and I said, my, could it be the crazy man they are talking about? But the thing that struck me was that as he spoke in tongues, then he told them, somebody interpret what I'm saying. I said, hey, what behavior is this one? It's really, really crazy, I tell you. He was speaking in tongues and telling those following, somebody interpret my tongues. I said, wow, this is amazing. So I stood there and I spied him a little bit. So they went. But I identified one of the people following him. She was a classmate of mine, Adelaide. So when we went to class the following day, I said, Adelaide Baden, I saw you with this guy. So he said, he comes to call out to do evangelism and all that. So, you know, offhandedly, we're just saying in some way, you know. So we're just going to do evangelism in the Commonwealth Hall. And she told me that, he has started a little fellowship. And they meet at E9 on top of the bookshop. So if I would like, I can come. So I will be there. So the Wednesday evening, I was there. There were about 10 of them. And he was teaching a Bible study, just teaching on new creation and all that. I said, wow, that's interesting. was talking, and after he finished talking, he said, let's pray. And we all prayed. They said, okay, one person, like you do in scripture, you know, one person should summarize our prayer. And I decided to pray. I prayed. And when I was praying, I knew that I was praying. So, so you see, I opened my eyes when I was praying, and I saw he was also spying this guy who is praying. What a shock. You see, I tell you. So deep calleth unto deep. So when we finished praying, then I took my Bible and I was going. Then I heard somebody calling me. When I said, what's your name? I said, my name is E.T. Saki. He said, my name is Doug. And he said, I like you. I said, I also like you. That's all. That's all. And it has been liking up until today by the grace of God. Somebody shout hallelujah. Are you there? It was the speaking in tongues and interpretation that led me. So let us have it in our church. Are you still here? It is biblical. I say, he that prays in tongues must also pray that he interprets. So you can speak in tongues and interpret your tongues. Are you there? We must have, look, and it was a common thing in those days. You know, when every time, you know, because of medical school, after evening, you come in, and when he comes back from college, you come and call me, and then we go and pray. And when he comes to call me to pray, he will just come behind my window. I was upstairs. And he'll shout, Kabola Mash, and then I also respond with tongues. And I'll take my shirts. You see? Major Murphy was my roommate. So when he said, oh, your crazy friend has come, I said, yeah, I'm going. And I wear my shirts. And we walk all the way, I mean, on the campus, speaking in tongues. And as we speak, we get to a point as we're praying. Then you start praying in tongues and I'll interpret. And I pray in tongues and he'll interpret. That's how it was. I tell you, we just pray in tongues. And I'll say what he has prayed in English. And I also pray in tongues and he also interprets. It's a spiritual friendship and a spiritual relationship. Are you there? Let us move into spiritual activity. Manifestation of the Spirit of God. Phanerosis. Somebody say phanerosis. Are you here? Let us have spiritual friendship. Not this of sending useless text messages, jokes and silly things and nude pictures and all this rubbish. Are you still in church? Useless WhatsApps. Am I talking to anybody here? Let your church be a spiritual church in the name of Jesus, where there's manifestation of the gift of the Spirit. He that prays in tongues must pray also that he interprets. And it's all by faith. Do you understand what I'm saying? Interpretation of tongues is by faith. That is prophecy is tongues and interpretation. It's equal to prophecy. I want us to enter into that area of our ministry. I tell you, otherwise, our churches will become like Orthodox churches. A time may come when even speaking in tongues, you have to whisper it. Because you don't want to offend anybody. You want anybody to find that it is, oh, see, we have all types of people who come to the church. All who come to the church. If you go to a beer bar, drinking spot, they say because you don't drink, everybody should hide their beer. Yeah, they drink openly. This is what we do here. So when it comes to our church, this is what happens in our church. We speak in tongues. We prophesy, we interpret. That is what happens in the church. That is the church. I said, that is the church. It's not abnormal. It's unusual, but not abnormal. Amen. It should be common in our ministry. I wish that we have even husband and wife who speak in tongues and interpret. That would be classic. Can you imagine? Reverend Lisa will begin, Kabotarabashat, and the wife will just interpret. And her children will begin to interpret and speak among themselves. I see it happening in our lives in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Yes. When I go home, me and my wife will start it. My wife, when she's speaking in tongues, is too gentle. I tell her, Your tongues, the devil's not afraid of your tongue. You pray coolly. Kalama shama nirimo. Zumanleki matanshanda. Vali mato. Marama kaba. I said, it's too nice. Kabo fato baha. Kilo basuki tata. Rado kobondi fata. Limo sakatu basiki. Masuki baha. Pray some wah tongues. Are you there? Yeah. Wah tongues. I'm telling you, we are entering into the things of the Spirit. I said, the things of the Spirit. Are you there? Yeah. Joel and Jason speak in tongues and Jason will interpret. And you speak, and that's how it should be. Say amen. It's possible. I say it's possible. Let us have spiritual experiences in our church. It's in the Bible. I say it is in the Bible. It's not an abnormal church. It's a biblical church. That is why you left Catholic. That's why you left all these type of churches. Because you felt that they are dry and dull and boring. How come we are bringing it into our churches now? The only place where there's life is our praise and worship. After praise and worship, everything is like orthodox. How come? The praise that we have is people dancing, and after that, that's all. But now everywhere, they are also dancing. Go to Catholic church, they are dancing like we are dancing. All of them are doing. There must be a spiritual atmosphere in our church. Yes. We respect personalities too much. We are too careful at offending people. Oh, you see, if you do that, not every type of person will come to your church. What are you talking about? Did they say that if the nightclub, if the lights are too dark, not many people will come? Then if you don't, that's how it is in the nightclub. The lights are dim. That's the life here. So when you come to our church, there's manifestation of gifts of the Spirit, speaking in tongues, interpretation, prophesying. It will happen in our churches in Jesus' name. It is not fanaticism. It is biblical. I say it is biblical. Am I talking to anybody here? Are you still in church? I said, are you still in church? In the book of Acts, it was there all the time. Oh, they said that your handmaidens will prophesy. Your servant and your maidservant. I'll pour my spirit upon them. They shall prophesy. I hear you prophesying in the name of Jesus. Pray for it. If you speak in tongues, pray that you will interpret the tongues. Amen. Pray that you interpret the tongues. Bishop was telling us, he and the Archbishop, Dr. Williams, when they call, he will call and then they start speaking in tongues. Pray in tongues, and this one pray in tongues like that, and then they hang up. Okay, see you later. That is the type of friendship that they have. Isn't that beautiful? Dear Joel, can you imagine? Dear Joel always calls me problems. Oh. He's never called me that we are just praying. Because no. So Bishop, sometimes I even avoid his calls. Because if I pick his call, he will hang up. I have so many other things to do. So he called me, he will talk up. But now, I'll pick your call if you speak in tongues. What do you call? Tell it how. And we start. Hello, Shabbat, Toraba. You see, as we are dealing with the problem, we are dealing with them already in the realm of the Spirit. Look, let's call. Let's pray. Do you understand? Let us pray. For the past few weeks in my church at the Kadesh, we wake up 3 to 5. We just speak. I said, no prayer. We just pray in tongues. So hear the phone ring. No, just start praying in tongues. Kando Shikib, 2 hours without stopping. 3 to 5. Let us enter the realm of the Spirit and deal with issues in the realm of the Spirit. Let's bind devils. Let's overcome demons. Let's take territories. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Are you here? We are going to be spiritual. I said, we are going to be spiritual. Reverend Bailey, we are going to be spiritual. I tell you, wake yourselves up and just pray. Just pray. We are just praying. We are just praying. We are just praying. The talking is too much. The complaining is too much. The grumbling is too much. The issues are too many. Let us now begin to pray and pray and pray in tongues. in the spirit, in the spirit, in the spirit, in the spirit. Are you ready for a new look? This is a new era for our lives. That's what I'm talking about. The anointed and its anointing. May that anointing rest upon us in Jesus' name. Are you there? Oh, yeah. It's a good experience you're going to have. Are you with me? When yes, but you see, when Bishop was in this, it was I had this fellowship at the Allegro University of Ghana. One time, I remember, you know, we used to have all night every Friday. And one Friday, as we pray in the classroom, he just called me aside and said, I should take them. We should take them to the gardens, botanical gardens. It was dark. So when we were praying, I just clapped my hands and said, okay, all of you, we are going down to the gardens. They said, no, we won't go. We won't go. Bishop said, look, we are going. So we led them to the gardens. But you see, we had wild believers. One day I was praying in the garden with somebody. And as I was praying in the night, about 1 a.m., I saw a fireball. I mean, a size of a football, maybe a bigger than that, just a few meters away from us. Bright, real fireball, bright. I mean red and shining, just a few meters from us. So my friend said, what are we going to do? I said, let's chase it. We said, let's speak, so running towards the thing. And then it just went off. Then we stood where it was and we began to pray, and we saw it far away. We would have arrested the devil physically and brought it to Accra Zoo. We have taken the devil to Accra Zoo. We are chasing every devil out of our territory in Jesus' name. Out of your family in Jesus' name. Are you there? Are we going to be a spiritual church? Spiritual people? Yeah. And you see, speaking in tongues, you see, the more you pray, the more even the vocabulary change. Haven't you realized that when you start speaking in tongues, you're saying, ba 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 ba, ma 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 ma, ba 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 ba, ma 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 ma. And the devil tells you, that's not how Bishop Joel's tongues are. When they say, bind the devil, ba 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 ma ma, ma 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 ma, don't worry, don't worry. When your child starts speaking, isn't that how they start speaking? Mama, 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 mama. You don't give your child a knock for saying mama, mama all the time. You rather encourage him to continue speaking. As you speak, the vocabularies are going. The more you pray in tongues, the more vocabularies. You are going to speak in tongues with comma, apostrophe, full stop, question marks. Are you here? I said, are you here? Let us be spiritual people. Say amen. Spiritual relationships. Spiritual. Everybody stand up and pray in tongues for just 3 minutes. Just pray. Kando, rabo kafata. Hold your neighbor's hand. Squeeze the hand and pray. Karosh kibaha. Vandi kibota. Fandi ribahata. Marondi siko ramahata kathi. Zubrande frakato rabande. Rabakato tarimo shkibaha. Mali fatika limo sikifata. Bahandu robo shkibaha. Manika suterimo shkibahade. Ve tatu rabakatiria. Brondi fanda rako takandi. Masuki fatata. Masuki fatata. Rakota bandiribo shibadi. Vikatundi kisata. Maiko tika bali fitu toriandi. Rakubaha. Yes, pray. Pray in the spirit. Karon nasito roma kafadidi. Rakuto mahandi fanini. Moski baha takadi. Mo kabita vura kandu kuzi. Masiko blahifo tati. Brakunka balidi mokati. Mo siki baha. Brakufa kandiri motikia. Brokafata. 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 Rakubahandi. Mianto kolde. Remo sibradi. Vrakunduromoshki brahane. Mi to Roma kifa dinki motisidi. Mazinduromoshebra. Brokofandirimo katintia. Broka baha kadini. Masobati. Masobati. Vakito rabakuli. Maali to kun ani subriene. Brain kinto rondo soria. Brain to randihi. Rondiri baha. Rondihi baha. Niko bani. Nirindi nini. Rokobol remesato. Maita tata rekido. Brehuni. Mahiko kobaha. Makundina. Maalito kumbahane. Mansi. 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 Fuko uka man. No, Biandukubaha, Mranita Turoshke. One more minute. Pray in the spirit. Pray in the spirit. You're changing levels in your tongues. You're changing levels in your prayer. Raka Kahande. Shkibahato kanita tata. Hey, mahakumba. Baitoka, baitoka. Matikoko bahadi. Renidili no mosubrande fanduria. Renikoto kandiri. Zumblane, zumblane, zumblane. Mahiaku kufatita. Rekaton kabe. Hey, hey. Mansodi, mansodi, mansodi. Frakoka bahata taya. Brakindo romo shiki bahati. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. May there be manifestations in your life. Manifestation of the gift of the Spirit. Manifestation of the anointing. Manifestation of the power in our lives. Manifestation. Manifestation of the anointing. Rakota nirimo shabadi. Malifa tundi kibahata. Masuki bahata romasi. Makindo robo shkibaha. Malifa kota behi. Sanina, 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 sanina. Maroka bandirimo shibra hatate ya. Moke bandiki totate. Masuka bandirimo kabaha. Mito randi. Skiba, 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 skiba. Oh, yes. Thank you, Father. 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 For your anointing. Anointed to prophesy. Anointed to speak in new tongues. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. We bless your holy name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Put your hands together for the Lord. Amen. Tell your lady standing by you, from now, no more gossiping. Don't call me and gossip again. If you call me, we are praying in tongues and interpretation of tongues. No more gossiping. No more complaining. In the name of Jesus. Put your hands together for the Lord. And you may be seated. Hallelujah. Yes. 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 You shall be known by your spirituality. You shall be known by your spirituality. You shall hear the voice of God. You shall speak the voice of God by faith. In the name of Jesus. Number 5. Identify the anointed by his predictive prophesying. Predictive prophesying. Bible says, then Samuel took a vial of oil and poured it upon his head, that on Saul's head, and kissed him, and said, is it not because the Lord hath anointed thee to be captain over his inheritance? And the Spirit of the Lord will come upon thee, and thou shalt prophesy with them, and all that, talking about what will happen after Saul had left him. After you leave here, many things are going to happen, and thou shalt go down before me to Gilgal, and behold, I will come down unto thee, and all that, and so on. All of it was just predictive. And when they came thither to the hill, behold, a company of prophets met him, and the Spirit of God came upon him, and he prophesied with them. And it came to pass, when all that knew him before time saw that, behold, he prophesied among the prophets. Then the people said one to another, what is it that has come upon the son of Kish? Is Saul also among the prophets? Wow. That's what they say about you. Are you also among the prophets? Are you also among men of God and women of God? Yes. Those who knew you, they knew him as a son of Kish, but they'll know you as a prophet. They know you as a person with the gift of God manifesting in your life. Amen. Even David, that will be your story. That will be your story. Are you also among the prophets? Are you also among the prophets? Now, Samuel was telling Saul what was going to happen. So you see the anointing. As the man is anointed, everything that he spoke came to pass. God would open your eyes. You will see there's descending of spirits. There's word of knowledge. There's word of faith. There's working of miracles. May this gift of the Spirit be distributed in our church, in our lives. You see, when I was praying for this camp, that was what God was putting in my spirit, that let the camp distribution of the gift of the Spirit in the church like never before. Like never before. We have too many good teachers. We need to have miracle workers. Good teachers are moving into miracle working. Word of faith. Word of wisdom. Hallelujah. You lay hands and God will speak to you about a person. And it will come to pass as God has said. Can you believe it for yourself? Can you believe it for your church? Yes. Yes. It's amazing. It's wonderful. Well, I'm excited because I sense his presence here. How many of you know, can sense the presence of the Lord in this place? You can sense it. I'm telling you. His presence is here. His power is here. Amen. All these things are given as an evidence of the presence of God. When the church is anointed, the gift of the Spirit in the church. Amen. Gift of the Spirit are in the church. Working of miracles. Word of knowledge. Word of faith. Descending of spirits. Amen. Prophesying, interpretation of tongues, all the gifts are going to be clear, evidential in our church. Put your hands together for the Lord. Chapter 4. It is the anointing that breaks the yoke. Hallelujah. It is not education that breaks the yoke. It is not money that breaks the yoke. It is the anointing. Did you hear that? It is anointing that breaks the yoke. Many people are under heavy yokes. I'm telling you, heavy yokes. Years back, I preached, went for a convention once in a church in Switzerland, and there was a very nice lady was in the church. Would come to the church in and out, but quite actively to a point. And after the convention, I went to a church in England, and about a week or so later, I got a call from our pastor in Switzerland. At that time, it was Apostle Dodo. He called me and said, about 3 a.m., he said, Reverend Saki, where are you? 3 a.m., where should I be? I'm not a wizard. I'm sleeping. 3 a.m., I'm in bed. So he said, please wake up. I said, what's going on? He asked me, do you remember this lady that was in church and all that, prayed for her and all that? Do you remember? I said, I remember her. And he said that she's dead. I mean, she was maybe in her late 50s or maybe early 60s. Now I can't remember exactly. But very beautiful, pleasant lady. He said he was dead. She was dead. I said, what happened? Then he told me this lady had gone for a Bible study in a friend's house. And then in the night, it was getting late, about 8, 9 p.m., he took the train and got off. Their home is about maybe 300 meters from the train station. So she didn't have to drive. So she took the train and coming home, she got off the train, and the husband normally meets her at the station and then they walk home. So the husband met her as usual, and as they walk through the little alley home, the man pulled out a knife from his coat and drove the knife through the wife's stomach, this way and that way, until all her intestines gushed out. It's amazing. So the lady fell and bled and died. And then the man carried his wife, placed her behind the garden, and covered her with a cardigan. So I said, what? Where is the man? And he said, the man is also dead. After he killed his wife, he went to the train station, waited for the fast train, and jumped in front of it. And the train just mashed him so much, became just, they had to use shovel to collect what was left of the man. I went back to Geneva. We did there. I mean, I saw the lady's body and all that, but I didn't see them. Nobody was allowed to see the leftover of the man. And they were buried next to each other. In fact, two of the children are pastors in our churches now. Now, it's a very unfortunate something. You see, later on, the children were telling us that this man was very depressed. He had a very good job working for the United Nations, earning thousands of dollars, drove the best car, fly business class or first class, quite rich, wealthy person. I mean, anything he wanted, he would get. But he was so depressed. The children said he often when he's angry in the house, he'd say that one day, I'll kill all of you and kill myself. But they always thought it was a joke. I mean, how can he do that? Until that day when he murdered his wife and then killed himself. But you see, he was under heavy yoke. In spite of the job that he had, in spite of the car that he drove, for the money in his account, he was a depressed person. Look, don't allow depression to control your life. I'm telling you. The spirit of depression is a yoke. Do you understand? This man was under, the conviction I was preaching, he was there. In fact, when I called to pray for him, I said, come and pray for you. When I laid my hand on him, it was like I've laid my hand on stone. You know what it is? You pray, know that the prayer is not working. Just prayed, and then I just said, you should just go. I could feel it. Do you understand? There's a heavy yoke on the man's head. A few weeks, he was about to kill his wife and kill himself. You know, there's some spirits that control people. Very strong. And you need an anointing to break the yoke. Do you understand? And if you are here and you're also working under depression, from time to time, you get depressed. You withdraw from everybody. There are people like that. You are okay. You dance and all the bad. You have that moment and periods of withdrawal that you don't want to talk to anybody. You lock yourself in the room. You cry for no reasonable explanation. You don't know. You feel the heaviness on your life. That yoke might be broken in the name of Jesus. Don't live here with that yoke. Do you understand? Don't live here with that yoke. Because that yoke, if it is not broken, it will destroy your life. One day, you'll be surprised where it can take you. You may be a believer. You're a believer already. But it's a yoke. The yoke of heaviness. When it comes on you, it's like a blanket that has been thrown over your head. Darkness all around you. You may even be you may look like a sanguine. But sometimes in your room, you feel that strong spirit of depression. If you are in that condition, at the point we are going to pray for you, that you don't have to live here with that yoke on your head. Are you still here? You are otherwise a nice person. But sometimes people are not able to relate with you because your sin has come. Your sin has come. That spirit has come. You are a very pleasant person normally. But the certain thing, when it comes, nobody, your husband cannot relate with you. Your friend cannot relate with you. Nobody can come close to you. You become irritable. Everything irritates you. Even your own children irritate you. Yeah. I'm telling you. You see, that spirit is a very strong spirit. I'm telling you. I know a certain lady also in our church, also in London. Originally from Ghana. This lady's she didn't have a child. They were married for a while. They struggled and believed God. Finally, they had a beautiful daughter. And the lady's mother was looking after the daughter when they went to work. Not knowing the lady's mother, the daughter's grandmother, was suffering from depression. They went to work once. When they came, the woman has killed the little girl, about 1.5 years old. Knife like that. Cut her into pieces. It was in the news, Sky News, and all the news. So we went to bury the little girl. But you see, some of these things that you don't know, it is a spirit. Don't joke with it. Some of you have a very bad temper. When your self comes, nobody can handle you. Anybody who cross, even if Apostle Joel comes, you tell him your peace of mind. And then later on, you apologize. Look, it is not normal. It is a spirit. It's not normal at all. Because you're a very nice person. Very good shepherd, very good pastor. But in that moment of your abnormality, you see, you like to say everything and speak anyhow. You don't care whatever. Then later you come and you are crying. I'm so sorry I said this. Please forgive me. You'll be forgiven. But the spirit is not a forgiving. It's a spirit that might be driven out of your life. Are you there? Am I speaking to you here? Listen, if you are struggling with that, we must deal with it in this camp. Are you hearing what I'm saying? We must drive it out of this camp. And some of them, some of these heaviness and yokes, they come from our backgrounds. Sometimes the way we were brought up, maybe you were a rejected child. You went through all sorts of rejections in your life. You went through periods of nobody wanting you or whatever and so on. So that thing has become a hold on your life. You grew up from a family or background of also rejections and also of this. You see, when you are rejected, there are two reactions that come out of a rejected person. Number one, you either withdraw from everybody. You become very paranoid. You don't trust anybody. When you see people talking as if they are gossiping about you. So how come they are talking when they saw me coming and they kept quiet? You always feel that somebody's against you. You always feel that people don't like you. If someone says, you're looking very nice, you tell yourself he's lying. Are you there? Yeah, it is a spirit. It is a spirit. You can't accept commendations about yourself. Everything, you're always withdrawn. That's one reaction. And then reaction is violence. If you have gone through rejection, you begin to be violent. You fight everything that comes your way. You are a fighter. You're always opposing things and fighting. You are like a rebel because you rebelled against that spirit of rejection in the wrong way. And so that thing, you see people who, in two ways, some are very, those become armed robbers, they become very violent people, uncontrollable. You know, I know a lady, when she's angry in the house, she breaks all the glasses. She's married though. With her husband, she'll open the thing, take them and drop them, and all of them will break. Take glasses, boom, plates and anything breakable, she will break them. And then when she finishes and when she's calm, then she'll call her husband, let's go and buy new ones. The husband will also follow her and they go and buy new ones from the shop. A lady told me, she said that when I'm angry with my husband, I take a glass and I go behind the house. I said, this is my husband. I crash it and break the glass. This is demonic. It is demonic. Are you what I'm saying? Look, there are a lot of spirits that are in control. But Bible said the anointing breaks the yoke. That yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. Can I have an amen? Amen. Look, I had a little struggle with that when I grew, because my mother tells me that I said over and over again, when she was pregnant with me, that was when the marriage was not working. So they decided that this child should be aborted. You know, because I come after the two boys were there, and then I was the one who is coming. And so when they were deciding that marriage should be dissolved, that's when she discovered that she was pregnant. And so we don't need another child to come and interrupt. You know, some of you are mistakes. You are not a planned child. Yes, you are not a planned. That's why you're so ages are very close like that, you see. You're not a planned. Just some Saturday entertainment, and then you arrived. You are actually a product of entertainment. That was not the plan. Yeah. Yes. And you know, I know. Reverend Francis says afternoon jump. I know. You see, some of those who are parents also, be careful that don't sow a seed of rejection in a child that you're not expecting. You became pregnant without expecting the child. If you don't receive the child a certain love, without realizing the child will be born, but the spirit of rejection can live in the child. Without even saying it, because you are always angry. You are just about to do a certain course, go to school, and realize you are pregnant, and so your life was interrupted. And so there's a certain anger that is transferred to that child. So the child will be born okay. You will not say anything, but a certain rejection will live in that child. So be careful. Be careful. What you think is a mistake, be careful. You don't sow a seed in the child. So my mother tells me that they said, oh, this child should be aborted. So she went to see a pharmacist who gave her medicine to take so she can flush down yours truly. What a shock. No, I'm telling you. So when she saw, did all that, and 2 weeks, 3 weeks, nothing was happening. The child wasn't coming out. So she went to see a more qualified pharmacist who looked at the medicine she was taking and said, hey, listen, when you take it when you're pregnant, the child's bones get strong. That's why I shout the way I shout. And I dance the way I dance. Somebody shout hallelujah. They told my mother that it was too late. If she aborted this child, both she and the child would die. And she was not ready to die. So I had to be kept. It's called divine mistake. Are you there? So right from birth, I was like an unwanted child. I was not supposed to be. So in fact, as long as, and I say this very carefully, my father is concerned, I didn't exist. Because it's my mother's mistake. She didn't take the right precaution. Or she didn't do the right thing. So as far as she's concerned, he's concerned, the children he has with my mother are the two boys. And I didn't exist. I was a little child. You know, this one I was told when I grew up. But as I grew up, it was a struggle for me. Because my father didn't know me. I was playing football with my friends. And I see my father. I said, that's my father coming. I said, are you sure? And when he comes to pass, good morning. Good morning. He said, how are you, young boys? And he'll pass. My friends will laugh. But I'll go home and cry. All my life in school, nobody visited me, ever. Not one day. And when I say that my name was always tops, those who owe school fees, my father had a good job, working in a bank, but as far as he's concerned, he's not interested. I'm telling you, when I was going to university, my clothes were packed in an empty milk carton. Yes, empty milk carton, two shirts, two trousers. Yeah, as you say, pants. That's what I had. And all those things, you know, I was a Christian, born again, active, but there was a spirit of rejection that used to torment me. I was a leader of Christian fellowship. I'll come to church. I'll lead prayer meetings and all that. But sometimes when I go to my room, I'll lock my door. I said, Major Melfo was my roommate. He will tell you, you know, he was a very difficult person. When I'm sad and I'm not happy and then the food is, won't you eat? Then you eat all the food. I'm sure he's laughing at me in heaven. He and Juanita, they're laughing at me. May God forgive them. I mean, I've not met any cruel, uncaring roommate like this before. He's not here to answer. So won't you eat? Okay, me, I'll eat, and you eat everything. I thought you'd be a little more merciful. Very ruthless. Anyway, so it was a struggle. So I locked myself in the room. I feel so sad. After we come from church, we're all dancing, shouting. When I go to my room, I'm so withdrawn. Feel so depressed, very strong. And I was full of bitterness also towards my father for all the struggles. I always told myself, you know, I cannot revenge in any way. But one day, I'll become an important person. One day, you know, I wanted to become important to prove a point. You cannot live your life to prove a point. You must live your life to please God, not to prove a point to any boy or any girl. That boy who didn't marry you, I'll live my life, I'll do well to prove a point. You can't live your life to prove a point. Are you hear what I'm saying? You cannot live all your life to prove, you must live your life to please God. That's what's important. But my aim was to prove a point. I'll study very hard. I'll become this and so on. And he'll be ashamed. Look, when I finished school, I qualified as a lawyer. And I was being called to the bar. They gave us 2 invitation cards. So I sent one to my mother, one to my father. My father came for the call to the bar. He didn't even know the son whose call to the bar he has come to. So when I got there, the program was supposed to start around 10 a.m. When I got to the place, what the security man said, hey, I said, the man has been looking for you since 6 a.m. 10 a.m., he got there at 6, when he was supposed to start at 10, looking for his son. So when I saw him coming, I also deliberately passed by. I said, good morning. I said, good morning. And then that's my daddy. And I said, daddy. He said, oh, is that you? And then we hugged. I couldn't even release my hand because I was crying. I didn't know how to. Mercy. Are you there? Are you there? Oh, yeah. I'm telling you. I mean, it was a difficult moment. You know, God woke me up one day about 2, 3 a.m. And I struggled. God told me that if I do not let this bitterness go, I will never do well. I said, no. You know, I told myself, I'm not bitter. I'm not angry. But it was there. It was there, a facade. Oh, I've forgiven it. But inside of me, I wanted to live to make a point. It was bitterness and the rejection. I struggled with God for about 2-3 hours, praying and struggling like Jacob struggled with the angel. At the end, I said, Lord, I let everything drop. That is when I saw a turn in my life. Am I talking to anybody here? Some of you have gone through some periods of rejections. Nobody seemed to have understood you, but something happened in your life. And that thing is eating you up. You are in church, you are a shepherd, you are a pastor, you are active in the church, but there's something inside that is a yoke. And that yoke must be broken. That yoke must be lifted up. That yoke must go away from your life by the anointing. Are you there? I thank God that I was released and I saw my life take a certain turn when I allowed that yoke to be gone. Are you in church? I'm saying to you here that don't allow these things. And if you know they are there, let's deal with them at this camp. Are you here? Let's be honest with ourselves and with God that this thing, this guy who didn't marry you, who says things about you, it is eating you up. That thing is inside of you. That experience that you had, it seems to be strong and you are struggling with it. And if you don't let it go, you stay at a certain level. The yoke will be so heavy on your neck, you may do the unthinkable if you don't take care. Let's read again, Isaiah chapter 10, verse 27. Can we all read it loud and clear? Ready, go. May every yoke be destroyed at this camp because of the anointing. May the anointing destroy every yoke that has been on your life. Can I have an amen? That yoke shall be destroyed. That yoke shall be destroyed. I said, that yoke shall be destroyed. Are you with me? We are going to be praying for you. Because you cannot come to this camp as you talk about anointing to live with the yoke in your life. The yoke that has controlled you up until now. You will not go with it. You can be happier than you are now. You can enjoy your life more than you are enjoying it now. But that yoke takes away a certain joy and strength out of your life. Taking it out of your life. But God is going to help us. I said, God is going to help us. I feel we should pray. Stand to your feet and let's pray. Just begin to pray now. Just begin to pray now. Kandorolomosh kibahato ramanda fadi. Karamash kabatorodobo sifradi. It's okay. Just pray. Kandarama shaka bahato shani. Randari mo kabandiri mahakatandiri moski. Kalandiri mo shkibahataya. Oh yes. May the yokes be broken. May yokes be broken today. May yokes be broken today. May yokes be broken today. Lift your voice and pray. Kandora no moshi kede. Put your two hands on your head and let's pray together. Manda katora masha bandi kifata, randi kibota fandiri mahata, zindri mosh kibaha, vandiri makatondiri bahakatandiri basi, vandi katosh kabadi, rankatondi baha, bandi kitosha kabahata, vandiri mokandiri mosibraha fandiri makataya. Zikitando kabata ran kindoni rababanderi makato ramasi zumana fatika tirimoshi kalaba randi kifotandiri bazi skobahata kandirimosh abedi. Pray this afternoon. If there be any yoke lacking somewhere, rakato shabata komali fatika lumasita. Fakatandiri mo shabadi. Fakatandiri mo kabasita. Vandikibato kabrakata. Oh, and it shall come to pass in that day. In that day, his burden shall be taken away from off his shoulder. His burden shall be taken away. God is taking away burden off your shoulder. 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 And yoke from off thy neck. Yoke from off thy neck. Kato shakata. Vandiriba koroma kesodi. And the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. The yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. Rakota shiki bahatandi. Zumbraza frakat oromo shedi. Ivaka toroma kitoka baha. Pray this afternoon. Yes, you cannot carry the yoke. You cannot allow the yoke in your life. You cannot allow the yoke in your life. It cannot control you anymore. 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 Kado shakato. Zumbra kafandiriba. Some of you, your spouses are struggling because of that yoke that you carry. Your husband, your wife is struggling. Pray today. May I be released. Yes. That yoke shall be lifted off your neck. Kado shaka mahato. Zero water family bakata. Handimosh kibahato. Sumbali fakandi baha. Pray.
Yeah, I'm gonna be lifted up.